With silent, lifting mind, I've trod the high, untrespassed sanctity of space, put out my hand, and touched the face of God.
The graves will always be there, and so that is something that a person can visit and realize that the school was in Tyrrell.
The terrible summer of 1940, when the skies over England were filled with death. While Americans were enjoying peace, Great Britain was in a desperate fight for its life against the Nazi forces of Adolf Hitler.
You ask, what is our aim? I can answer in one word, victory. Victory at all costs.
Almost every night, the German bombers rained destruction down on London and other cities. Hundreds of the English people were killed. Against huge odds, valiant men of the Royal Air Force fought back. They shot down great numbers of enemy planes, but many of the RAF pilots lost their lives.
Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.
Fearing a German invasion, Winston Churchill turned to his old friend, Franklin D. Roosevelt, for help. Secretly then, the U.S. president agreed to let young British men come to the States, where Americans would teach them how to fly.
What they did with the first groups until Pearl Harbor is they brought them to Canada, discharged them from the Royal Air Force. The American government issued them a 6 months visitor's visa, and so they came on down in civilian clothes.
I started out keeping a scrapbook. I've got the first articles that came out in the Tyrrell Tribune about the school, and I said, where they said in the paper that foreigners were coming to Tyrrell, I said, maybe Dallas or Fort Worth or some other place, but not Tyrrell, not little Tyrrell. Foreigners coming? But it wasn't any time until they were home folks. And they were just, they just became a part of our family.
I've never known anybody quite like Bill Ibbs. He was handsome. He was devoted to his family, especially his mother and his sister. And he was so appreciative of everything that was ever done for him. It was such a happy time. And Christmas was a big thing for the Allen family. And he was a very real part of it from the very beginning. I remember we made movies of it, and I don't know, it's something that I'm still touched by.
Clad in civilian clothes to avoid attracting attention, the Brits showed up at the first British Flying Training School at a small airfield in northeast Texas. Right away, they were thrust into grueling days of hard work, learning all about engines, navigation, weather, airmanship, how to spot and identify aircraft. Once in the air, the cadets were taught instrument flying and how to maneuver at night. Eventually, out on the prairie of Texas, more than 1,400 British pilots earned their wings, but some never saw combat. The first casualty was Cadet Richard Mollett. Just 2 days before he was to graduate, he went down with his airplane and was killed. Then, just a week later, things changed forever. Aircraft from the Empire of Japan attacked a faraway place called Pearl Harbor. With America now in the war, the Brits started proudly wearing their blue RAF uniforms into town. Into 1942, the flying courses grew from 20 to 28 weeks. As the training intensified, so did the dangers to the pilots.
It was in January that one morning, about 7 o'clock, the phone rang. And it was Kenneth Tuttle calling from the airfield. And he asked to speak to Mr. Allen. And so I knew something terrible had happened from Buddy's voice when he answered. Well, it seemed that the night before had been a terrible night. There was a terrible storm. And he had gone on what I believe was to be his first night flight before he received his wings. And he didn't come back. But what we understood was that his radio went dead and he was no longer able to communicate with the field. And all he could do was just fly around and around, and then he ran out of gas. And he was buried the next Sunday.
As the English servicemen got their wings, in tearful farewells down at the train station, they said goodbye to their Texas friends.
It was quite an emotional time when we were leaving Terrell. We have pictures of all of our gear stacked up waiting for the train, and then maybe 100, 200 people just mixing and saying goodbye.
They were heading back home to the real thing now, war in the air to save their country. In battle, some of the men lost their lives. Many earned medals for their extraordinary feats of courage. One who will never be forgotten was Arthur Aaron. Badly wounded by fire from German fighters, in great pain, he managed to land his crippled bomber and to save his crew. Aaron was awarded Britain's highest military honor, the Victoria Cross. At the airport in Terrell, there is a museum that helps to keep alive those times gone by, the memories of the British pilots and their American friends.
These were the last to graduate in August of 1945.
But the dream of the people of this area is to create something greater, a larger space to display more artifacts, more photographs, more of all of that precious history.
We have copies of film made in the early courses of some of the cadets acting out foolish stunts like flips and flops and all that in the backyards of these people. And of course, the whole matter of enjoyment, it helped. The 6 months went by too quickly.
There are plans to bring some of the trainers the Brits used, and even some of the warbirds they flew so long ago when they helped to save the world. To accomplish that, in America, in Europe, in many places, money is now being raised for a new museum, a place to better preserve those stories of toil and sweat, of sacrifice and brotherhood, a place above all to remember. In the quiet, tiny cemetery, they are still here, the boys from Britain who never made it back home. With loving hands, the people of East Texas who knew them all these years later still tend their graves, lest we forget.